Okay, yeah, thank you. Okay, hello from my side. I'm Carsten Risse. This is a cooperation between the University of Osnabrück and the University of Applied Sciences of Osnabrück. It's a cooperation of Oliver Formberger. He's already also here. And main of the work is done by Benedikt Engelbert. It's part of his PhD thesis. But unfortunately, today is at another conference, so he can't be here personally. So I'm Carsten Risse. So the use of user-based video tags in a recommender system scenario for learning material prediction. So after languages and media analysis or film analysis, we all three are computer scientists, and all, everything we do here is with our view as a computer scientist. Let's start with some words of motivation. We have some tradition in using lecture recordings. We use lecture recordings since 2005, so more than 8 years. And we developed since 2007 a concept of a flipped classroom concept. So where we use the lecture recordings as an integrative part of our learning concept. And in the beginning, we started with the lecture recordings as an enrichment to our classroom lectures, and then we continued with that to a flipped classroom concept. And besides that, we developed a lot of material in form of a script, textbooks, e-assessments, slides, annotated slides, a lot of material. The same is if you go to the internet. The internet is a massive collection of information, data, and services. You have, for example, you have documents, you have emails, you have, for example, Facebook, you have other libraries, so a massive collection of services. And since a few years, recommender systems came to the market. What is a recommender system? Easily speak. It should help to identify the most important or appropriate information regarding the user's interests. It works just like a filter for your documents, and the filter should take into consideration, for example, the service itself, the time, the location, the emotion of the person, and then make some recommendation for the user which data he should use. So what's the definition of a recommender system? Quite an easy definition. Recommender systems try to help users to access complex information spaces. A more elaborated definition. Recommender systems suggest items of interest to users based on their explicit and implicit preferences. And what are the issues dealing with recommender systems? You have to deal with user profiles, you have to deal with the preferences of the users, you have to identify similar products, for example, so you have to deal with similarities. Of course, the valuation of products, for example, you can distinguish explicit valuation or evaluation. So if you make a rating of a product or some kind of implicit valuation, for example, if you buy a product, it's also an evaluation of that product, because if it's not interesting for you, you won't buy it. There are several strategies. There is the content-based filtering. That means that you look at the properties of items, what are similar items. And another important strategy for recommender systems is the collaborative filtering. The collaborative filtering, there you compare user profiles, and you can take a look on similar user profiles, and if a user with a similar profile behave in a specific way, you can learn from that behavior to give a recommendation for another person. A very well-known example, for example, is the Amazon online store. I think everybody knows that. So if you buy a book, then you always get some information of some similar books or of customers who have also bought other books from the same field of interest. Now let's transfer that to the learning process. What is the technical support of a learning process? Usually you have a learning management system in the middle that could be StudIP, it could be Moodle or something like something else. You have a lot of documents. You have, for example, some forum or chats or wikis there. You have external links which are collected in the learning management system. You have lecture recordings, for example. You have quizzes. You have some bibliography information. And the idea is to transfer the idea of the recommender system to the learning process. So the basic idea is that you also put a recommender system as part of the learning management system and to integrate a recommender system into that infrastructure. And the main idea or the main goals are to make a recommendation of interesting learning material for a specific student or appropriate learning material, and to optimize the learning process of the student. So the basic idea is we try to visualize let's call it the graph of insight of a student. That are the weeks of the semester in the lecture, and he starts at level zero or over zero, and he gets some input over the weeks of the semester. He gets some presentations, for example, and then he gets some hints on additional literature. And sometimes we as a lecturer produce some kind of a dent in the graph of insight of the student, because it's too difficult for him and he's confused about that material, and later on he gets some other lectures and he the learning curve is going up and up, hopefully, but it's not always a linear process. And what we try to do introduce is some kind of a recommender system to optimize the learning process, to make it smoother, the learning curve, and to avoid these kind of dents. Yeah, for example, you get some presentation, and then the very difficult stuff, you get, for example, video information, for example, instead of a difficult book, where for his purposes, for his cognitive abilities, it's much better presented, so that the learning curve doesn't go down, but it goes always up. In the ideal case, at the end of the semester, he has gained more insight than in the regular way, but that is not often, or that it might not be the case, but it could be. So what are the influencing factors in using a recommender system for learning purposes? So one issue is that some material was not considered from the students, or some parts of the material which was presented to the students was omitted, so there's a lack of knowledge. Sometimes the learning material is not really understood, or it is misinterpreted. Another issue is that if there's too much material, he gets some feeling of disorganization or some excessive demand. There's an overburden or lack of knowledge for him or her. And another thing is, as I already mentioned, it's the cognitive ability. Sometimes there are different materials or form of materials better for some students than for other students. So what are measures to deal with these issues. So Uffie can recognize that there's a lack of knowledge. So because he has omitted some material, so we can present them the unused material. Or if there's some kind of misunderstanding of some information, we try to find some more suited material so that we can present it. We try to support him in his organizational stuff. If there is some kind of excessive demand, we try to find out how is his actual or current knowledge already is, for example, if, in doing some tests to prove his actual knowledge, and to try to find something out about his cognitive abilities. So what is our approach? The approach is to use tags within the learning material, so as a kind of annotation. And we try to use five different kind of tags. One tag is an explicit rating, as you know it, for example, from Amazon. You can give from 0 to 5 stars. Then you, to give free comments. For example, you say, oh, that's a good stuff here. That's an important point for me. Another thing is to use predefined comments. For example, oh, this is a difficult part of the video, for example. Oh, this is very assistive. That is very fine for my understanding, or that is very significant. The fourth tag type is to use highlights, like a text marker. And the fifth one is to use new material, so for example, to give a link to another material or source of material. And the use of tags defines some kind of an individual learning path or a user profile for that user. Let's have a look on an example. For example, if you have a lecture recording, you can use, for example, a predefined comment, say, oh, that is an explanation of regular expressions in theoretical computer science. It's the definition of that stuff, and it's very difficult, and there's a much easier example given here in that link, so to annotate that kind of lecture recording. And it's quite important to try to identify what are the important parts in the learning material. And we try to do that by looking on all the comments of all the students. For example, here, the same scene within that video. We have 5 students from A to B, C, D, and E. A says, oh, that's an important thing here. For B, it's very difficult to understand. There's some better material on that link here. Oh, that is relevant here for the exams, for example. And that is very basic here for this topic, for the definition of the regular expression. And like B, E finds it very hard to understand. So some free comments, some predefined comments of the user, we try to bring that together to define or to identify important parts within that video. And the assumption is that if there are some students that find a part in the material helpful, other students might think that as well. And the same is if there are some students which find some material very difficult, others might have the same feelings. But the question is, how do we find the important parts within that video? The important part of the video, it depends on 3 issues. One is the number of requests or the number of tags. The second is the relevance. So what type of tags are given from the students? And the third one is an explicit rating of some kind or some portion of material. So the number and value of ratings. And we try to identify that. And how can we use it? So how do we use the important parts? Of course, it is related to his or her learning path. And we try to discover whether a student has problems with the topic, for example, or if there are some parts in that material which he has left out. And if we find that out, we try to give some recommendation so that we give some hints on undiscovered parts in the same material, or if we can recommend him related parts from other materials. That could be an article, a book, another video material. And we try to do that on every type of material, but in the first step we use this for the video content. Of course, the benefits of tags or annotations in video content have been investigated in the past in several studies. Of course, if there is a work in an active manner, it enhances the learning process. It helps the students to pay attention if they are motivated to give some annotations. It stimulates the discussion and gives some kind of feedback to the students itself, for example, if they do a presentation by themselves. This has been investigated in several studies, and we use it in our scenario of lecture recordings. And the challenges, the challenges are how to find the important areas in that video, because usually it will come out that the texts given by the students are widespread over the video timeline. And if you use free text comments, they are quite vague, or there's a quite vague formulation. You have to interpret the free text comments. That's very difficult. So, and usually the video itself, it's a linear medium. It's there's no generic structure in it. So, how can we do that? For example, if we have frequently set tags, for example, we have two scenes of a video. Here we have annotations. Here we have some annotation that is a hint for an important part of that video. We have two topics here. They are highly requested, so that's a good idea to put that together to one topic and to say, oh, that's important because there's a lot of traffic from the students. Then we look on the annotations, the type of annotations. It's much easier to say something about the annotations if we use predefined comments. We think it's a good idea to use four types of comments: something about the difficulty of the stuff, assistance, understanding, significance. And the idea is to divide the text regarding the comment category. Mm-hmm. And to use the free text comments just for the discussion. Yeah. The preference to use predefined comments was already investigated by another study. And let's have a look on some more examples. And some more difficulties to identify in the parts within the video. If there are neighbored videos or areas with different topics, for example, we have a lot of traffic here, a lot of annotations here, and we have two types of topics in that area. For example, one topic, another topic. We can't put them together. because there are two different things. And we can't distinguish between those two areas by just the number of tags. There some kind of quality distinction is necessary. So here we can use the different type of tags. For example, we analyze here the color of the tags. The red color stands for it's difficult, and the yellow one is for assistive, and the green one for significant. Then we try to divide that areas here by investigating the type of comments. And a third idea is that the students can define some topic areas by themselves, and to use them for the detection of important areas. Here we have two students, a blue one, a red one, who define some kind of area within that video, and to say, oh, that's important for me, for my learning process. The idea is to use that as a hint to structure the video itself, to divide it in several areas. The last thing is, if the students want to add some additional material, for example a link here, it's quite easy if it's in between one topic or another topic, but it's difficult if it's just in between those two topics. Then we want to do that manually, to say, oh, that's a link for that topic or for that topic. Yeah. Now my last slide, some discussion about that. So of course, a recommendation only works if there's a lot of usage of that system. So one important thing is, how can we motivate students to use these kind of systems? Yeah, the idea is to use some kind of a learning diary and to ask how they are learning, how are they using the material, and to motivate them to do that. Another question is, what is the target group? Is it independent from the scientific area, or is that more a system for, let's say, computer scientists or engineers, or is it also can be also used, for example, for the media area or for the language departments. And the last question, how can we use the data of the past semesters? Can they be used to define some kind of learning path for type of students in the following semesters? Thank you for attention.
Thank you. Are there any questions?
So you mentioned tagging for figuring out which parts of the videos, for example, are hard for the students to see. But have you also thought about maybe doing this in an automatic way that you can just watch, take a look at how often specific parts of the lecture were watched? Because I think if a student doesn't understand something, he or she just moves back to an earlier point in time and watches the video again. So this could be a good indicator without the necessity for the students to take.
Of course, that is an indicator. I think since several years we are using the Matterhorn system, and there is some kind of viewing statistics. Mm-hmm. And of course, it's a good indication if the curve is going up in the usage of the system. Mm-hmm. But for example, if there's a good joke in the lecture, yeah, mm-hmm. The viewing statistic will go up. And that's not important for the learning process mm-hmm. of the students. So it's not the only idea to have the automatic way, but we want just to investigate that by explicit recommendations.
Are there any other questions?
to put any link, like further link to internet or whatever in the video, or can you maybe?
No, that is the idea, to have access to the open internet, because there's a lot of content available. Me as a lecturer, I think there are other lectures which are very well, and why not look, have a look on these kind of things. So it could be an open link, yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Awesome.